Today, we are joined by Dr. Dave Brain, who is a professor at CU Boulder and a researcher for the Laboratory for Atmospheric and Space Physics, also known as LASP. He specializes in atmospheres and magnetospheres at Mars and elsewhere in the solar system, and is a member of the MAVEN spacecraft team, which is currently studying Mars's atmosphere. He is also a science advisor for the Emirates Mars Mission, or EMM, a new and exciting mission originating in the United Arab Emirates that plans to provide a complete picture of the Martian atmosphere at high altitudes and close to the surface. Dr. David Brain, thanks so much for being here with us today.
Thanks for having me.
So I'm going to start with kind of just a generic question that I think is important for background when we talk about Mars. We often call Mars the red planet. What makes Mars red? And was it always that way?
Probably not. So Mars is red because the surface is oxidized. And so in simple terms, Mars rusted. And on Earth, oxygen can react in the presence of liquid water with iron-bearing minerals, and that turns things red. And essentially the same thing has happened on Mars. This is something that accumulates over time, and so that tells us that there was sufficient oxygen in the atmosphere to react chemically with the surface. And we have confirmation, we think, that Mars wasn't always this way, because we've sent rovers to the surface and they've been able to dig down a little bit below that very surface layer. And when we look at the surface material just below that surface layer, it's more gray than red.
Okay, so with that being said, in other words, like you said, the surface of Mars has rusted in a sense. Mm-hmm. This is just a silly question, but here on Earth, rust tends to cause a disease called tetanus. Can this happen on Mars? Would we be at great risk just by being on Mars of experiencing tetanus because everything is iron oxide? Is that rust?
I don't know the answer to your question and haven't thought about it before, but I do think that there are a lot of other things to worry about before you get to tetanus on the list of priorities. Sure. The list of things to worry about, tetanus isn't even in the top three, really.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So you say the top three. Do you have, like, just off the top of your head, the top three things to worry about as far as humans being on Mars?
Oh, I don't know if I have it prioritized in my head.
Emphasizing that tetanus was not one of them.
Right. I can list several things that I'd worry about first.
Okay.
One would be air to breathe, which you have to either bring with you or make once you get there. You have to think about access to liquid water, which we need. You have to worry about the radiation environment on Mars with the thinner atmosphere. You don't have as much protection from radiation as you do in our own atmosphere. You have to worry about, generating power for yourself as well. I'll stop there. That's fine. But, anything that you need for day-to-day survival would come before tetanus for me.
So what you're saying is that by the time we are worrying about getting tetanus from Mars, we're probably pretty well established on the surface of the red planet. So much
yeah.
so that, we might be living there full time. That's
That would be unfortunate if we have jumped through all the requirements and hoops necessary to keep ourselves alive on Mars and tetanus is the one that gets us.
Yeah, that'd be too bad. Sorry, this is super off script. That was just a thought that I had, and now we've gone down that hole.
I'm willing to riff. This is fine.
So another kind of background question to just set the stage for the rest of this conversation. I'm going to ask you what an atmosphere is, scientifically speaking, and why does it matter in the conversation about Mars?
Wow. So we're going to start off with, just simple, easy, small questions, it sounds like. An atmosphere is a gas, a collection of individual atoms and molecules. So it has to be in gas state. And those individual atoms and molecules are bound gravitationally to the planet. That would be my definition of atmosphere. But they have enough energy in those individual atoms and molecules to keep them off of the surface as well. They can be colliding with the surface, but they're atoms and molecules above the surface, but still gravitationally bound. It's important for any number of reasons for many different planets. If you're a person that's very interested in life at the surface of planets, then an atmosphere is critical for a variety of reasons. Maybe most important of which is that it provides sufficient pressure and greenhouse warming to keep water in a liquid state, or it can provide sufficient pressure and temperature to keep water in a liquid state. All life needs water. But even for a planet without an atmosphere, you could consider it to be important or crucial in shaping how that atmosphere might look to us today. An atmosphere can drive erosion. An atmosphere can interact chemically with the surface of a planet. An atmosphere can have clouds and other dynamic features that when we look at it from far away, that's what we see instead of the surface. And it can do a lot to shape the surface of a planet. It may even be possible on planets like Venus that the atmosphere influences the spin rate of the planet itself. Even though it seems like it doesn't have very much mass, the constant flow of the atmosphere over the source and the torques created from that can maybe change the rotation rate of the planet. So it can be important for a huge number of reasons. Also radiation, which we talked about a little earlier in this conversation, that can shield the surface from the radiation environment.
Sure. Okay, cool. So I am of the, you mentioned that you know, one of the reasons that this atmosphere is important, or an atmosphere, is to maintain the correct pressure and temperature for liquid water. As we know, we do not see liquid water on the surface of Mars today, but we do see perhaps some signatures that it was there in the past. What happened, to the best of our understanding as the scientific community, what happened to Mars's atmosphere such that at one point in time it allowed for liquid water, but today it doesn't do that?
Yeah, it's a puzzle that we're still trying to piece together all of the details. But I think, you know, at a very high level, we can say what happened to the atmosphere of Mars. So as you said, there's evidence on the surface that liquid water used to be present. This is both chemical evidence in terms of some of the minerals that we see that require liquid water, and even the shapes of surface features that suggest that liquid water once flowed or sat there. That means the atmosphere had to have been thick enough to support the liquid water. The atmosphere is not sufficiently thick today. Okay, so to zeroth order, we can say that the atmosphere was lost. We can give a little more detail than that as well. Some of the atmosphere we know was lost to space. And that's those atoms and molecules in the atmosphere got enough energy to escape the gravity of the planet. And that's part of my research area and my involvement in the MAVEN mission, is thinking about how much atmosphere from Mars could have been lost to space, and it's a lot. But that's not the whole story either. We are very confident that some of the atmosphere was lost down to the surface and the subsurface. I don't know if you're going to edit out certain questions, so I have to stop alluding to earlier points in the conversation. So let me go back. We're also confident that part of the atmosphere has been lost to the surface and subsurface of the planet. The planet's red because it basically rusted. That's pulling oxygen out of the atmosphere. We see polar caps on Mars, which if Mars gets cold enough, are going to grow and grow and grow. And we have plenty of evidence that atmosphere has gone down to the surface and subsurface as well. So the combination of these two things, loss of atmosphere to space and loss of atmosphere to the surface and subsurface together, we believe has changed the atmosphere enough that liquid water is now very difficult to have be stable on the surface of the planet.
So kind of bringing that home a little bit, obviously, you know, we've seen a pretty significant impact on the atmosphere of Earth, in recent years. But I'm kind of wondering, you know, as far as changing the atmosphere, Is there any conversation about, you know, do we expect any sort of similar thing to happen on Earth with the atmosphere being lost either to space or to the planet? Is that, or even on Venus, where, you know, the atmosphere is in a totally different spot, with, you know, the runaway greenhouse effect. Is that something that we is common, or is Mars kind of an outlier in that way?
That's a good question, and I can maybe give you some unsatisfying answers. So first, atmosphere is being lost from Earth and Venus today as we speak. And for charged particles, which are my specialty, the atmosphere is being lost at almost the same rate as it's being lost from Mars today at Earth and Venus. Yet Earth and Venus still have big, thick, robust, happy, well, Venus maybe not so happy, but big, thick, robust atmospheres. And that's because those two planets are bigger than Mars, more gravity, better able to hold on to their atmosphere. Also, bigger means more geological activity inside. And the geological activity has been robust for longer at those planets. So they're generating new atmosphere through volcanism. So it's not just atmospheric escape that we have to think about. It's also how atmosphere is generated. What is the size of the planet? So every planet is unique in its own way. And it's the combination of these characteristics that tell us whether we think the atmosphere should be retained or not.
So that would explain why, for example, the moon, Earth's moon, has no significant atmosphere, because it's not massive enough to hold on to it, nor is it hot on the inside anymore to, you know, have those geological processes that would help contribute to it. Is that right?
That's correct. The moon doesn't have a robust atmosphere like those three planets. It does have individual atoms that are kind of bouncing around, but more often than not, they're escaping away to space. So, you know, the moon has a really puny gas envelope around it, and it's because it's so small.
Very good. Great. Thank you. So let's kind of change gears from atmospheres and talk about kind of, you know, what has been exciting people about Mars, which is the idea of going to it. Do you have any, what plans does the U.S. have of going to Mars, if any? What is the current roadmap? I know that there's the Artemis mission kind of going on and stuff, but what can you say about, you know, us going to Mars?
Here's what I can say about us going to Mars. For as long as I can remember, the U.S. has had some kind of plan to put humans on Mars or the moon and then Mars. The current plan is called, I think, Moon to Mars or something like that. And it has humans on the moon by 2025. And with a more vague direction to have humans on Mars by the mid 2030s. And I think that's the plan that's currently in place. But, you know, every time there's an election, then there's a potential for that plan to change. And so maybe the optimistic thing to say is people really want to have this happen. They want human presence to expand in space. That seems to be a constant element of the plan. The details of the plan change, you know, on 2 year or 4 year or 6 year cycles. And that's where we are right now.
Well, and that's important because, you know, when we're talking about space travel, the details are extremely important. And so even if on the whole, everyone says, yeah, of course we want to go to Mars, if those details change, then that really kind of stops the process and restarts it from square one again.
It can, especially because it's such an expensive endeavor. So right. If you're fundamentally changing your approach while keeping the goal the same, if you fundamentally change your approach, that can be an issue.
Is there anything about this round, this Moon to Mars, installment of Let's Get People to Mars that is particularly promising or hopeful to you? Or does this seem just like the rest of what you've observed, and that you expect things to change and will kind of continue moving in the direction, but, you know, still kind of in limbo?
Yeah, at this point, you're getting used to more complex answers from me, never a strict yes or no. So the plan itself feels similar to previous plans, with more urgency for getting humans to the moon. I'm not sure I've heard of a timeline this fast for trying to get humans to the moon. So that's a new element of the plan. What is different this time around, and maybe this plan and the previous plan, are the external influences that are maybe starting to drive things a little bit. The participation of private industry is increasing, as we just saw in the past few weeks. And international efforts for space exploration beyond low Earth orbit are also increasing. And these two things, I think, are going to drive things rapidly at some point. In the age of coronavirus, we've all learned about exponentials at this point. And I think this is another area where we might witness sort of a sea change all at once, where suddenly things are going along as they were before, and now look at us go, we're really going.
So in the past, humanity as a whole, have relied on kind of the government space institutions, for NASA, for example, to do the work of getting people into space. And like you mentioned, you know, there are some now kind of like private external players in this industry. SpaceX is the, Oh, sorry about that. I clicked in my my back window and Zoom went away. I thought I lost you.
Okay.
Let me restart that because I just interrupted myself.
Yeah.
So in the past, we as humans, you know, collectively have kind of relied on the government institutions like NASA to do the job of putting people in space and doing that, you know, space science and research. But like you mentioned today, we're kind of seeing more involvement from kind of like private companies, SpaceX being the obvious example. You know, and I guess that idea of having these private space industry players can be a bit controversial within the astronomy community. Getting to Mars has been a huge push within parts of the private space industry. And that's, you know, that's one of Elon Musk's like whole things is let's go to Mars. Do you see any particular pros or cons involved with, you know, kind of invoking the private industry in the huge undertaking of going to another planet?
Yeah, and I'm glad that you cast the question in that way. I think they're both pros and cons. I'll preface it with a statement that private industry has always been involved in human exploration. And the change more recently is being involved at sort of the idea level, the top level. But, you know, the space shuttle, many different parts of the space shuttle were contracted out to private industry. When we sent the MAVEN spacecraft to Mars, you know, certain circuit boards or certain aspects of that are always contracted out. So there's, and when the rockets that we put our spacecraft on, many of them are built by ULA down in Denver. So private industry has always been involved in space exploration. And the change we're seeing here is The change we're seeing here is Elon Musk and SpaceX having a plan for start to finish, making it happen themselves. You know, Jeff Bezos being involved, Blue Origin being involved, these companies that want to do the whole thing themselves. So that's the big change. Some of the pros are that private industry is less risk averse than government. Every time a mistake is made or an accident happens, people correctly go back and examine why that happened, put procedures in place to prevent that from ever happening again. And this is all done not maliciously in any way. It's done out of, you know, care for human life, which we should always be very careful about. But it also ends up putting on layers and layers and layers of bureaucracy when it's run by government sometimes, and that can slow things down and make more make things a little more expensive. Private companies have the privilege or are in a position to be risk averse and to move very quickly. And I hear about the very early days of NASA in the early 60s and even into the late 60s when people were there, you know, late into the evening and all through the weekend, and there, you know, it was really energetic. And those are the same kinds of things that I hear about the people at SpaceX today, moving just as quickly and just as fast and being just as passionate about what they're doing. And people at NASA today are super passionate, but the two modes, private industry and government, just move at kind of different paces sometimes and with different amounts of expense. The same con, that same thing that's a pro is also a con. If you're more risk averse, then more accidents are likely to happen. And when we're talking about sending humans to a place where we can't go rescue them, that's, you know, something to think really carefully about before you do it. A second thing for maybe the scientific community is the fact that private industry doesn't always have scientific interests, you know, at heart and their root cause. Sometimes there are noble causes involved, but at the end of the day, the company won't exist unless they can, you know, make money by doing it, which means that they have a ranked priority list and tetanus isn't necessarily at the top or the bottom of their list. And so in terms of preserving, not preserving Mars, but in terms of learning everything we can about Mars without first interfering with the things that we want to study is maybe not at the top of the priority list for private industry. And so one thing I've been told in terms of in my positions on sort of national service committees, thinking about what our priorities are for Mars exploration, I've been told that we need to put our science priorities that would be tampered with if once humans land on Mars, we need to put those at the top of our list now because humans are headed there and there's no stopping it. So, you know, that's something I think about as a con from the perspective of a scientist, is contaminating the planet, interfering with the things that we actually want to study.
You know, that reminds me of this. There, I think this is not really a thing anymore, but I could be wrong. A while ago, I heard about this really silly sounding program called Mars One. And the whole idea behind Mars One is that they would send 100 people to Mars and fund it by making that whole thing a reality TV show. So they would just film what happens when you send 100 people to Mars and then sell ads on that, and that's how you would fund the mission. But yeah, it's definitely interesting to think about, you know, when you start, you know, allowing private businesses to do this, you know, or when they start doing it themselves, then you kind of run into these really odd, you know, these things come up and you're like, wow, that's very much different than kind of what we have been used to and expecting from the scientific community. So
yeah, I've heard Mars One, you know, was a thing for a while. We don't hear about it anymore. And I'm not even sure if it's, you know, now defunct, but, and I'm not saying that private industry is bad, a bad addition.
No.
But they sometimes have multiple goals that they have to satisfy. And those additional goals can sometimes come in conflict with the science, the pure science goals.
Do you think that there will be one day when, you know, like on Earth, right, there's people do stuff most of the time, people are doing things not in the name of science. Like most of human activity isn't in scientific pursuit.
What? Why?
I know. It's ridiculous. I can't fathom. But what I'm asking is, can you envision a point in history, maybe well beyond, you know, our epoch? Do you think that there is a time when that is true also on Mars, when you can make a Mars reality TV show and people don't really think twice about, well, that's going to interfere with the science? In your vision of the future, do you think that we'll have a kind of presence on Mars to the point where, you know, science is still happening, but now people are doing things simply because they want to do them and it's no longer a scientific objective?
On Mars, you mean?
On Mars, right.
I do. I think that. Yeah, I think that for a variety of reasons. But I think your question could be paraphrased, will humanity someday live on Mars?
Right. That's a great point.
And I think that is inevitable. And I think if it isn't inevitable, then our species might be in trouble in terms of its long-term survival. You know, if we're talking about big, lofty, grand ideas, then we only have about 5 billion years left on this planet. So we have about 5 billion years. If we want to survive as a species, we have about 5 billion years to figure out how to expand away from this stellar system to others. And learning how to live on planets other than our own is a step in that process. So that was very long term, but you didn't put a time frame on your question. So I'm going to say my answer was legitimate. And then if you want to think about shorter time frames, you know, we're happy to think about that. But, you know, I've taken the cop out way of, you know, thinking 5 billion years into the future. And I do think that about, you know, our species and our civilization is that, if right currently we have all our eggs in one basket, Earth, it's a beautiful basket. I like it a lot. But it's only one basket. And if our species wants to survive long term, we need to diversify a bit in terms of where we live.
Well, 5 billion years is a long time to make that happen. So I'm excited to see where we go with that.
Thanks.
I think I'll turn over the interview to Tara at this point, and she'll ask you some questions about your research.
Great.
Yeah, we'll switch gears a little bit. So you did talk a little bit about MAVEN already and some of the cool things about Mars's atmosphere that we've learned, but what can you give us kind of an overview of MAVEN in general, since I know that's a big deal for you kind of right now? What are some of the really cool things that we've learned? It's been up there a little while.
Yeah, first a brief introduction to MAVEN. It's a mission that was proposed out of the University of Colorado. It was competing against, I think, 22 other mission proposals from all around the country and was ultimately chosen as the winning proposal to send to Mars. It's a very large undertaking. I think maybe the largest research award in the history of the university or something like that. And I started working on this in 2004 when I was a postdoc. I didn't have children until 2006, so I've been working on MAVEN longer than I've had children. And it's been orbiting Mars since 2014, and the whole goal of the mission is to figure out what happened to the atmosphere and climate over the last 4 billion years of the planet's history. Did enough atmosphere escape to space to explain a big transition from a habitable planet to a non-habitable planet? So maybe the biggest result from MAVEN so far is that we estimate that a lot of atmosphere was lost. And that's how we wrote the paper. It was just a lot. That's what we wrote. No, I'm just kidding. We tried to put constraints on that. And the error bars are large, but maybe half of an Earth atmosphere in terms of pressure, that would be called half a bar. Maybe more than a bar of atmosphere has been lost to space over time. So these really cool physics processes that happen to particles at the top of the atmosphere are not just cool physics, which interests me, but they may have been important for the entire life cycle of the planet so far, which excites me. So that's one reason I like thinking about MAVEN science. There are some unexpected things that have been observed by MAVEN, for example, aurora in the atmosphere happening far away from any planetary magnetic field signatures. So this is maybe the first time we've recognized that you don't need a magnetic field to get aurora on planets. All sorts of new processes for making particles energized and moving them away from a planet. And I could go on and on and on, but I'll stop there.
Excellent. And so MAVEN's been up there and we've learned a lot from it. And now you're also involved in the Emirates Mars Mission, which is a new mission, which is super exciting, that's going again to study Mars's atmosphere. Can you tell us a little bit about EMM in general and kind of how it's different and what it's doing differently than MAVEN?
Yeah, so let me start with in general and then, as you said, move to the science. The Emirates Mars Mission started as a mission concept in 2014, and it's a collaboration with an agency, a space center in the United Arab Emirates. And they approached some institutions to be academic partners in their effort to send a spacecraft to another planet. The UAE has sent spacecraft into orbit around Earth, I think, three times before at this point. That had never sent a spacecraft to another planet. And so asked for some partners to help figure out how to do that. So it's a very interesting day in your academic life when someone walks into your office and says, we would like to send a spacecraft to Mars. What would you like it to do? And you know, there were ideas all around, but everyone was soliciting ideas and it was a fun exercise. This mission will launch next month in July. The launch window opens July 14th and stays open through early August. And so we could try each day to get the spacecraft off the ground and headed on its way to Mars. And one thing I didn't mention is the programmatic goals of this mission. You can edit all this later because I know this is way too long. One thing I didn't mention were the programmatic goals of this mission. One of the goals was to send a spacecraft to Mars for the 50th anniversary of the country. And so the country will be 50 years old very soon. And they want to do something big for this. And if you know anything about the UAE, you know that they tend to go big. They currently have the tallest building in the world, for example, the Burj Khalifa. They make land out where there was no land before in the shape of a map of the world. They're used to undertaking big projects. And so they wanted to send a spacecraft to Mars for the 50th anniversary of their country. That wasn't enough to get me really on board or excited. But when they told me why they wanted to do it, then I was in. They want to do it to help diversify their economy. They know that the oil economy won't last forever, and they want to transition to a knowledge economy. They want to be an example for young people in that part of the world of what you can do when you pursue big projects like this. They also want to join the international science community, and the more specifically the international space science community, and they want to develop space science and engineering as something that parents would want to tell their children to think about pursuing in that part of the world. And then when I met the science team, it was 100% female at the time that I met the science team, which shattered my expectations for that part of the world. And I admit that I was ignorant and had never been there and had not had a lot of interaction there. But now I have some lifelong friends from the UAE, I'm sure. And all of these programmatic goals got me on board pretty quickly. The science of EMM is very interesting. It's an orbiting spacecraft. And it's going to study both the lower atmosphere and the upper atmosphere. And it has three science instruments on board that work at three different wavelengths. There's a camera that takes visible images. There's an infrared instrument that probes the lower atmosphere, including temperature and composition. And there's an ultraviolet instrument that probes the upper atmosphere. And the idea is to figure out how energy moves through the atmosphere. You could think of energy as temperature of the particles, if you want, because that's the energy that they carry. But how does this energy get transported from place to place? How does it vary with Martian day? How does it vary geographically? How does it vary with season and year on Mars? And in order to do this, the orbit of the spacecraft is very special compared to any previous spacecraft to go to Mars. Most previous spacecraft orbit up and down over the poles, which means out of necessity, they always orbit at a single local time. So maybe 3 p.m. and 3 a.m. And if you want to understand the atmosphere of a planet, you might immediately realize that that's not ideal. It's like asking everyone on Earth to go outside at 3 p.m. today and take some measurements of the atmosphere and then run back inside and then use the measurements from 3 p.m. to figure out weather on the planet. That's not going to work. At the same time, we have rovers on the surface of the planet, like Curiosity, that's making temperature measurements and atmosphere measurements. Really great. You can't understand the atmosphere of a whole planet that way. That's like asking the people in Boulder to make measurements around the clock and tell people in the rainforests of Brazil how their atmosphere should be working. That's not going to happen either. So this spacecraft orbits in such a way that it observes every geographic region of the planet at every time of day, every 10 days. So Olympus Mons, the big volcano on Mars, will have atmospheric measurements above Olympus Mons at every time of day, every 10 days. And so the orbit helps us tie those measurements together to understand circulation patterns and energy transport and bottom to top of the atmosphere as well. How changes near the bottom of the atmosphere propagate upward to the top and result in atmospheric escape. And that was your whole podcast right there in that one answer.
I thought it was awesome. No, that's really interesting the way that they've got that set up. That seems like a really important thing that we kind of need.
Yeah, we're excited to do it. And another nice thing about it is that it's relatively low risk. Each one of these measurements has been made before at Mars. We know how to build these instruments, and it's the combination of the instruments with each other and the orbit of the spacecraft that's going to open up whole new science for us.
So they were very smart about putting this together. They had good advice, obviously.
It's been fun.
If I could jump in really quick, I have a question based off of something that you said, which was that this, it seems like the orbit of this spacecraft is kind of, is going to be very dynamic and change regularly. Is that, does that require like a huge amount of fuel on board, or is that something that you can set up, you know, initially, and then it will just change itself naturally? You know, how are they accomplishing this cool orbit around the planet?
Yeah, the magic of this is that the orbit is really stable, so we don't have to do a lot of controlling of the orbit. The orbit, it will be very far from Mars compared to most spacecraft, almost out to the Martian moons, as a matter of fact. And instead of going over the pole, it will be equatorial, parallel to the equator of the planet. And finally, the orbit will be a little bit elliptical. So when the spacecraft is far away from the planet, it's orbiting slowly and Mars is spinning underneath it. So you get to see lots of different geographic regions at a single time of day, because the spacecraft isn't, you know, moving that quickly. At the closest point of the spacecraft orbit, the spacecraft is moving faster and maybe hovering above, you know, one single piece of real estate, and seeing how that piece of real estate changes at different times of day. Now, the things that I've just told you are kind of, I've glossed over a few of the details, but that concept is how the orbit is constructed.
That's cool. So it's got some unique stuff going for it as far as the setup and the science. I also wanted to ask you about, from a cultural standpoint, this is a huge deal for the UAE. You mentioned it's their 50th anniversary of their country. It's their first big interplanetary mission. And the thing that impressed me is looking at the pictures of the team members. It's a lot of young people. It's a lot of women. Do you know, from an advising standpoint, was this a conscious decision to sort of promote this sort of diversity in their workforce?
Yeah, from my understanding, and I haven't had explicit conversations with this about people, I've made comments, and many of us have made comments about how wonderful it is that the workforce on this mission is so diverse, and almost and also too how embarrassing it is that the workforce on the UAE side is more diverse than the workforce on the US side in many areas of the mission. But in terms of gender balance, I don't think it was a conscious decision. I think science is a field that excites everybody in the UAE and excites women in the UAE quite a bit. So in my role, I've gotten to go into schools and universities in the UAE and watch hands shoot up when I talk to a room full of seventh grade women about going to Mars. And they are so full of interest and curiosity, and the hands go up everywhere. When I go to the university, I've started talking about Mars and had people in the front row telling me things about Mars that I didn't know as undergraduate students. And I'm specifically remembering an experience where it was four young women right in the front row. And so I don't think it's a conscious decision, you know, we need women, let's go find women to join the team. I think it's people are passionate and interested about the project. So that's for gender balance. For youth, boy, it's incredible. You know, there are a lot of young people that are really passionate and really interested, and they just do things. You know, they decide something needs to happen and they go make it happen. And they don't, the thought that it might not be possible or it might not be something that they should pursue doesn't really go through their heads. Something that combines these two ideas together, youth and gender balance, is maybe my counterpart on this team. Sarah Amiri is her name. When I first met her, she was an engineer at the Mohammed bin Rashid Space Center, and eventually was chosen to lead the science team. And that put her into a high profile position in her country. She's been on TV all the time. She was being interviewed all the time. Her face was on the cover of magazines. And after maybe 2 years, she was named as the Minister of Science for the entire country. I think at that time she was 32 years old. And this is, you know, something that would shock any of us in the US, someone named Secretary of whatever. You know, you expect the minimum age there to be maybe 60 or something like that for those kinds of positions, not in the UAE. This is a country that came from the desert to the Burj Khalifa in 50 years, less than 50 years. They move quickly all the time.
That's so awesome. I think that's really, really cool. And kind of following on with that, so now you've been involved in missions from well-established spacefaring nations like the US, and now with newer sort of space organizations. Are there any other kind of things that have surprised you about this new crop of spacefaring nations, or things that have impressed you?
That's a good question. I think more impressed than surprised. I think it's inevitable that every country will want to, you know, participate in the exploration of space. The United Nations currently has an office that's dedicated to helping countries get into space, maybe through CubeSats or things like that, even if it's to just monitor their own land for where to farm or for natural resources or something like that. And so there's encouragement at the international level to get as many countries as possible into space. So I think that part was inevitable. And I shouldn't have been surprised by it. But, you know, there's not a lot of inertia when you're just starting. You don't think so much about why this shouldn't be possible or why this should be hard or, boy, think of all the steps that we have to go through. Instead, it's let's get there. Let's do this. Let's make this possible. There's a ton of energy and passion. And I'm not trying to discount the energy and passion from the more established nations either that are, you know, participating in the exploration of space. But, you know, for someone who's been there before and done it several times, you're still very excited, but there's nothing like your first project or the first time that you do something. And watching people participate in that is really great.
Very cool. So now let's kind of bringing it back home, I guess, to more US-based stuff. Right now, we're actually kind of in a really important time as planetary scientists. We're preparing for our decadal surveys. Kind of like we tell the government what we want, what we think is important for the next 10 years, and that's all anybody's talking about right now. Are there any Mars-centric proposals that you are especially excited about, or even non-Mars ones too?
Yeah, I think I consider myself a planetary scientist first and a Mars scientist second. So I'm interested in any number of things that help us understand planets better. I think, you know, that the systems of Uranus and Neptune are vastly underexplored. Voyager has been through each system once. I'm particularly interested in Neptune, but I would take either one. Uranus is wacky because it's on its side. Neptune is interesting because it has this big moon Triton that's orbiting Neptune backwards, and it's a captured Kuiper Belt object like Pluto. So you get two for one if you go to Neptune. I think that would be great. And also the sense of exploration for the younger planetary science community that would come with participating in such a mission, I think would be invaluable. I think the Venus community is clamoring to go back to Venus, and there are any number of unanswered questions about Venus that are not only interesting, but can help us inform us about Earth. I think it would be great to see more missions to Venus. And of course, I want to see more missions to Mars. Why would I not want to see that? And some of the things that I'm thinking about would be both scientifically valuable and maybe help inspire people a bit, have a little bit of a wow factor. I'd love to see a balloon mission on Mars. And that balloon mission could bridge the gap between landers and rovers, which explore only a small part of the surface of Mars, and orbiters, which explore the whole planet, but from, you know, kind of a global perspective. Something like a balloon, which drifts over the surface for, you know, days or weeks, can give you that same local perspective that a lander or rover can, but it can do it for many different parts of the planet. I happen to be really interested in magnetic fields and magnetospheres in addition to atmospheric escape. I consciously avoided talking about that earlier in our conversation because I didn't want to spend 90 minutes of your time on that. But I think putting a magnetometer on a balloon and getting low altitude measurements of the magnetic characteristics of many different parts of the surface would teach us about the deep interior of the planet and its history, would teach us about mineralogy near the surface, would have implications for our models at high altitude of how charged particles leave when they're escaping the atmosphere. But I also think images from a balloon, measurements of the atmosphere, even just knowing how the balloon drifts over the course of a day or week would teach you about the atmosphere. So that's just one idea, but I'm not a particular advocate of any of the things that I said. I want to see them all happen, and I want to see more than that happen. So I'm really interested to see what happens with the decadal survey.
Cool. So it sounds like you've got some pretty well-rounded interests. As most of us do as planetary scientists, we like all planets. But I know, as we also do, sometimes you kind of get pigeonholed into being Dave Brain, the Mars guy. So have you always been a Mars guy, or kind of how did you get to where you are now?
How much time do you have?
Relatively succinctly.
The most dangerous thing you can ask a professor is for them to talk about themselves. So here we go. No, I have not always been a Mars guy, but I've been a Mars guy for a long time. I've been a Mars guy since high school. But I've been a space and planets guy since at least fourth grade. And I've been a science person since kindergarten. And I won't bore you with all the details unless you ask. But for Mars specifically, after the Challenger exploded, I was in seventh grade when the Challenger exploded. After that, the space shuttle was grounded for a few years, and there were all sorts of reports about America's, you know, committees thinking about America's future in space. And one that was particularly influential for me came out in high school when the first George Bush was president. And it mentioned Mars as a destination for humans and a goal for humans. And I read that report. And at the time I was an intern at the NASA Center near where I grew up, NASA Goddard. And my supervisor at that NASA Center was on some of the committees that were thinking about this. And he brought me along to one of the committee meetings as a high school student. So the combination of reading this report, getting a summer internship at NASA, and being brought in a room where people were thinking about big ideas and goals just stuck with me. And especially what stuck with me about Mars is that of all the planets, it's the one that reminds me most of Earth. And you know, for a lot of people interested in astronomy, they're interested in the exotic. And I think it's so great that they are: black holes, galaxies, cosmology, the birth of the universe. For me, I have the most intuition about, you know, here. I can put my feet on the ground and I get some idea of what a planet is. And when I look at Mars, I feel like I have some intrinsic understanding of what it must be like to be there. But it's different enough that I'm fascinated in how it got to be so different. So I think I don't need it to be super exotic. I just need it to be different enough that I want to understand why and how it's different. So that was my long-winded answer to just one part of my path. But it's been since high school for me that I've been interested in Mars.
Excellent. Well, we're just about done. We're going to wrap up with the one last question that we always like to ask people. I'm going to let Colin take that one because I've been
talking. Oh, no.
So I actually, as we were talking, I didn't want to interrupt you guys' conversation, but I actually came up with two more questions in addition to this last one. If any of you are like, Colin, we have to stop. This is too much. That's totally okay. But I'll save the question that we have written for the last one, just because that's a fun, easy question that's pretty quick. This is actually, I have what might be kind of a tough question. I don't know, but I'll ask it anyways, which is, as you and Tara were talking kind of about the cultural importance for the UAE of going to space and what that will look like, it made me remember, you know, that there's a lot of people on Earth that, you know, in the past and today, that have asked the question, why, or I should say not ask the question, but hold the sentiment, you know, that we should focus on Earth issues rather than focusing energy on space, right? Especially, you take today's climate, right? There's a lot going on with the coronavirus and with systemic racism. And people are saying, you know, well, why, like, shouldn't we just pause things like space exploration and space travel and fix these problems first? How can you focus on these other issues while we have this at hand? And that's always been a thing, right? In the 60s, with going to the moon, it was Vietnam. And today, you know, it's what I said. And I think there will probably continue to be that kind of reaction to science and space travel. Do you have any, you know, how do you respond to when someone tells you that sort of thing? And I know this is kind of a tough question, so we don't have to go there, but you know, I'm curious to see what you think about that.
Let's go there. That's fine. And it is a hard question, and I don't know that I have fully decided what my answer is, but I've been asked this question. I was asked this question by another faculty member at the University of Colorado before the fall 2019 semester. And first of all, I think the question presents a false choice. I don't think it's either or. I think it can be both, and I think it's important to be both. I don't think we should abandon the problems that we're facing on Earth, from systemic racism to climate to coronavirus, to making sure that our planet is a place where we can not only survive, but be happy. We shouldn't abandon those things, and neither do I think we should abandon the big ideas that come from exploring space, that come from pushing ourselves in that direction, that come from wondering if we're alone. I think if nothing else, doing those things provides inspiration. And inspiration is important when you're tackling problems close to home. I've talked already in our conversation too about the all eggs in one basket aspect. And as much as I'd like to think we can and will fix all the problems facing us here, I worry that there will someday be a problem that we can't control and that we don't have a solution for. And so maybe the practical side of me also wants to see us continue to send spacecraft to really cool places. That's got to be part of it too. But I think it's a false choice.
Very well said. I like that, you know, we don't have to break it into either or. That's nice. And for fun, an example of an unstoppable problem might be, like you said earlier, in 5 billion years when our star dies. Yeah. Unless technology has really just gone off the wire, that would be a tough thing to say. Please don't. We'd like to stay here a little longer. So the other question that I kind of thought of as you and Tara were talking about your counterpart in the UAE, you mentioned that here in the US, we kind of expect, you know, the national voice. Remind me again, what was the position of Sarah over in the UAE? What was
her? It's a longer title, but it boils down to Minister of Science.
Minister of Science. And here in the US, we would expect someone with that title, like you said, to be old, you know, right, and have been in this for a long time. And that's kind of an active conversation today, especially with politics in the US. We look at everyone, you know, that is, you know, all the lawmakers of the country who are significantly, you know, older than a large chunk of the population. And so I guess my question is, what are your thoughts on this? In your opinion, after having seen how it works in the US and how it has unfolded in the UAE, should young people be the voice of the scientific community, you know, in a national sense? Or should those with more experience who have been doing this forever be, you know, the people to kind of guide us through the process of doing science?
I think it's a false choice. I think it should be both. And I come from, you know, maybe the gap generation, where in my generation, you don't wait your turn, but you develop as much experience as you can. You put up with some things that you don't really like, knowing that someday you'll be in a position to change those things looking back, or you'll be in a position to not experience them anymore. And so, you know, my generation might be more prone on average to patience and waiting things out and waiting till it's our turn. And then the younger generation is impatient. And if you look at how much our country has changed, you know, outside of science, being pushed by the younger generation in the last several years, socially, I won't mention specific things, but I can. But if you look at how much change has happened, even in the past 2 weeks in our country, that's been pushed by young people. And I think you need both. I think you need experienced voices in the room, calm, patient voices who have the long view. And I think you need people agitating for things to happen right now. And I don't think science is any different than, you know, socially in the US or politically or in any other way. I think there is not only room for both approaches, but both approaches are necessary if you're going to do things in a good way.
Thank you for, and this is true. This is a genuine sentiment. Thank you for thoroughly destroying my idea in my head that it has to be one or the other. Because in both of those, you were like, no, of course it doesn't. We can have both. And I guess I'm so used to today saying, man, you know, it's got to be this or this or this. And never, it can be all of these things. So that was very well said. Thank you for that. And thanks for kind of entertaining these more kind of political or uncomfortable questions, perhaps. Even as we're out of time here, past 5 p.m. So I'll ask the last question, which is a nice, easy, fun one. And the question is, do you have a favorite Mars fact or misconception that you'd like to share? Something that comes up in conversation a lot that you're like, no, this should be understood in a different way, or maybe something people don't know about that they really should because it's cool. It's something in that category of things.
Maybe not a Mars fact. I mean, there are certain things about Mars that surprise people the first time they hear them, as the biggest volcano in the solar system, the deepest and widest canyon in the solar system. It's has a lot of extremes. But currently my favorite, and not a lot of misconceptions so much about Mars that get under my skin. But my current favorite fact about Mars isn't about the planet, it's about its moons. It has two moons, Phobos and Deimos. And like all orbiting objects, one is close to the planet and one is farther away. Like all orbiting objects, the closer you are to the thing that you're orbiting, the faster you go. And the farther away you are, the slower you go. Phobos is close enough that it orbits faster than Mars rotates on its axis. Deimos is more like our moon, orbiting slower than Mars rotates on its axis. So if you were standing on the surface of Mars and you looked up into the sky, the two moons would be moving in opposite directions in your sky, which to me is a really cool fact. I don't know why that's my favorite one right now.
So if the moon is orbiting the planet faster than the planet is rotating underneath it, then is that to say that you could watch the moon go through a full phase in less than the course of a day from the surface of Mars? Or is that not right?
Well, except that it would go over your horizon. So you couldn't.
Oh, so you couldn't, yeah. So you wouldn't watch it, but it would go through its full phase in the course of a day.
Correct.
So the next time you saw it, it would be totally different.
Correct.
Whereas on our moon, it's very gradual. Very interesting. Yes. Yeah. Cool. That's awesome. I didn't know that. That's a lot of fun. All right. Well, Tara, would you like to do the honors?
Sure. So that was all the questions we had for you today. Thank you so much, David Brain, for joining us. We're very happy to have you on our podcast.
Thank you for having me. It was fun.